this is Debbie Levine. I'm the Senior Deputy Editor for Radiology, and I helped edit this special issue of Radiology called Exploring the Evolution of Imaging that we put together to help celebrate the RSNA centennial. I'm very happy to be talking today with Dr. Mark Schweitzer, who's the Professor and Chair of Radiology at Stony Brook University in New York. He wrote the review article, The Role of Radiology in the Evolution of Understanding Articular Disease, along with the co-author, Dr. Huang. So, Dr. Schweitzer, welcome.
Hi, Debbie. How are you doing?
Good. Nice to see you. Well, it's a lot of work to review the literature, not only in radiology, but almost the entire literature of musculoskeletal radiology when you're putting together a review article such as this. And I'm just wondering if you can tell us about the process and if you found anything unexpected.
What was really interesting is that musculoskeletal radiology goes back to the origins of radiology, probably more than any other field, maybe other than thoracic radiology. And to go through the history of the first radiographic description of osteoarthritis nearly 90 or 100 years ago, the first description of rheumatoid arthritis as recently as 50 years ago, and crystalline arthropathies as recently as 30 years ago. Pretty amazing that the descriptions that we use today were first described in our literature, in our journal originally, and have been basically only modestly adapted in the intervening decades. It's pretty amazing, actually.
And as you went through looking at all of these different articles, what did you find most interesting beyond just, wow, things haven't changed that much?
Well, they haven't changed and they have changed. So wow in that I feel proud that the original descriptions of these were often in the imaging literature, not in the rheumatologic literature. And wow in that we changed how the diseases are understood. And that's something I think is very important for radiology as a field and for my subspecialty within radiology. So as imaging techniques have evolved, we've been able to understand the pathogenesis and a natural history of disease. And that worked hand in glove with clinical medicine to help in our understanding of the disease. And actually looking back, probably a greater understanding of these diseases has come from imaging than from the clinical part of that. And it was, I guess I shouldn't have been surprised by that, but I was kind of surprised by that, but it leaves you with a pretty nice feeling.
Yeah, and what we really wanted from these review articles was to highlight how technology has changed our ability to make diagnoses. And obviously in musculoskeletal imaging, we've moved from the plain film, which we still use, of course, but now we've got CT, MR, PET, all this hardware and software that allows us to change diagnosis and maybe better manage patients. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about what you thought were inflection points in technology.
Well, actually, let's start out with the X-ray. So the X-ray was an inflection point of technology. So gout was first described by the ancient Egyptians several thousand years ago. But really, the diagnosis of gout wasn't made reliably until radiographs were discovered 150-some-odd years ago, less than 150 years ago. So that is an important inflection point. So the clinicians really didn't know for sure that this disease has existed or they existed in a given patient before the X-ray. You know, Rentgen's first X-ray was of his wife's hand. She was middle-aged at that point, and I'm guessing she had some osteoarthritis in that hand. And you can say the first X-ray did have osteoarthritis on it, statistically probably true. So the first inflection point, and still to this day, the major inflection point, was radiographs, because to this day, the diagnosis of osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, crystal disease, ankylosing spondylitis, seronegatives are dependent upon radiographic criteria. And if you look at the American College of Rheumatology, probably, if not the most important, certainly the second most important criteria would be radiographic criteria. Now, the second inflection point, surprisingly, was not CT. The second inflection point was really MR. And MR really helped to change our understanding because we went from osseous evaluation to soft tissue evaluations, and these disorders are predominantly disorders of soft tissue. So that inflection point was MR used as a morphologic evaluation, and then we understood the diseases as being what's now termed whole organ diseases, rather than just bone or osseous diseases. Then the next inflection point, I would say, was physiologic MR. The ability to intimate what the collagen status was like, what the proteoglycans were like, using quantitative and functional MR imaging, functional on a little different definition than would be used by neuroradiologic colleagues. But nonetheless, that was probably, after x-rays, the most important inflection point, because now we knew biochemically what was happening. So I would say the first inflection point was radiographs. The second was the ability of MR to provide the whole organ concept of articular disease. And the third was the biochemical quantitation allowed by advanced MR sequences. If I look back and think what was lacking or surprising was that CT up until today has played a relatively limited role, different than other parts of the body, and ultrasound for articular disease, for not for musculoskeletal in general, but for articular disease, has played a somewhat limited role. The future, I think, to a larger degree, will be physiologic imaging by MR and physiologic imaging by scintigraphic techniques, particularly innovative radioisotopes and on-PET imaging.
Yeah, you got my next question, which was the future. So CT and ultrasound, you know, my heart really lies with ultrasound near and dear, but it makes a lot of sense for articular disease. The ultrasound just can't get in there. What about the plain film in the future? What should we be doing with the plain film for articular disease?
It's an interesting question. So one of my colleagues about 15 years ago hypothesized that in 15 years we would be only using plain films for fracture follow-up and for ICU patients. Now, he was certainly wrong in a 15-year time frame. The question, is he going to be wrong in a long-term time frame? And I have a sticky feeling that he will be wrong in a long-term time frame. There will be a continued role for screening patients by radiography and for long-term changes on radiography. Now, the question will be, can we get something that's more advanced, inexpensive? And on imaging, we've concentrated on getting something more advanced and haven't really considered the societal costs as much as we will need to in the future. So if we can get MR to be much less expensive, probably there will be a limited to no role to radiography. If MR continues to cost between 10 and 100 times as much as a radiograph, there'll be a long-term need for radiography. Now, if something comes along that's somewhere between the prices, which statistically probably will happen, then that will accentuate the demise of the X-ray. But I still don't see that demise anywhere soon.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much, not just for your time today talking with me, but for all the work you put into finding the articles that you wanted to call out that have been published in radiology over the decades, and the images that really show how this technology has changed. I really appreciate reading what you have written, looking at the images, and then talking with you today.
Okay, thank you, Debbie. And I want to thank my co-author, Dr. Wang, who did an excellent job as well.
Wonderful. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.